today I'm going to tell you about a very exotic creature out there in my collection. It's a common house fly. So everybody's seen a common house fly? Yeah? You guys have a fair share of bugs here, so. Before I start, we're going to get very up close to these things. Things you've never probably been so close to these creatures. So I just want to know, who really is freaked out with insects? Please be very honest, I'm not going to get offended. Who really gets freaked out or thinks they're weird and would much rather squat them? Which is perfectly honest. Most commonly, that's the behavior we see. Okay, so we have a few people, but you guys are more brave, so that's a good start. Okay, so once there was a party. There is a party on this planet going on. I got an invitation to this party 150 million years late as humans. What party am I talking about? Is this a Halloween party? There are all these bugs with different costumes. These are pictures from the marine census that just came out of new species that were found very recently in the ocean. I can keep going, and it'll take me hours and hours and hours to just show you what just stuff that we discovered last year. The party I'm talking about is party of biodiversity. There is all this stuff out there, not just us, and we are only a part of this party. I was told to bring a prop, and my most favorite prop, believe me, is a pond scum. So I was going to bring a bucket of pond scum and ask you guys a very simple thing. How many do you guys think, how many creatures are out there? If you go out to a lake, fetch a bucket of water, how many have you caught? Anybody has a guess? 300? Millions and thousands, and the answer is we don't know. You could go out there and find something that nobody on this entire planet has seen before. And this doesn't mean you have to go to Antarctica or these exotic places. You can go in your own backyard. In a drop of water, this is a beautiful book that talks about all these tiny little things. These are single-celled plants. These are diatoms that are all very different and do amazing things that no scientist or any engineer could ever actually achieve as yet. Now is the bad part. I prepped you up. I have a feeling that there is something bad coming. The party is going to be over very soon. And this is why the party is going to be over very soon. I'm not going to harp on this of the bad things we're doing, but just believe me, or most of you that have already read, that things are looking really, really bad. We're losing things faster than we can actually discover them. So you might ask, what's the big deal? The point is, to be able to connect to these things, the things that you're actually losing, I think the big connection is knowledge. Just knowing something is out there is not good enough. It's just another name in another phyla, in another class, another species. Who cares? The point is, once you have knowledge, once you actually understand how this life works, you get to connect and appreciate it in a completely different way. This is what we are lacking in the debate of biodiversity. So the question today was, as the part is collaborate, what can you do? And I'm going to argue, you can go out there and discover stuff. Discover facts, discover things that no other mankind knows. So there are people in the past, and a lot of famous business leaders have done this before. They discovered coffee. This is a legal drug, talking about drugs on this stage, that all of us actually drink every day. But it was just found as a random plant in a rainforest. And the market grew from there on. A lot of people talk about that to have a sustainable biodiversity, we're going to find all the solutions to human problem in many of these things. There are beetles out there that at this very moment are chewing up antibiotics that we have no idea about. There is a glue that a mussel makes that you can actually use underwater. Rather than stitching your own stitches when you get hurt, you put the glue on and your body's tissue actually merge together. So there are these fascinating things that we as humans have no idea to imagine right now. So it's not about applying, going from a problem to a solution. It's going and finding out what's happening out there. So rather than the role of business leaders, I want you to be citizen scientists, take up your little lens, and go figure stuff out. And I'm going to tell you only one story of all kinds of things that we have found completely at random. We had no plans. Okay. So there is science in the middle. So why insects? I'm fascinated by them. They are kind of weird. They do very bizarre things. This is a water strider we discovered that actually walks on water. When you poke at it, it has a capability to gallop, just like a gallop of a horse, but completely on a water surface. They are beautiful too, not only from the outside, the parts that you see, but as an engineer, they are beautiful from the inside, the way they actually work, the way they perform the things that they actually perform. And in my opinion, the coolest reason to study insects, they are the aliens of this planet. There's a beautiful documentary that came out on aliens of the Amazon. The bizarre ideas that they have are really outstanding. And I think it would be a shame if we really actually didn't look at them very closely and try to figure out what is going on, where are we missing all these ideas. Okay, so here is a confession. They also do bad things. So a common example are all these diseases that flies actually spread, and a very common one is the African sleeping sickness. This is a testis fly that has a parasite that actually gets transferred to humans. There is a cure for it, but diagnosis is extremely hard, and large parts of Africa are actually suffering with this disease. Once we take a closer look, we actually start to understand how we talk to them. There is a Facebook of this world. Everybody is talking to everybody. And now I'm talking not about just our species, but every other species in some way is connected. And so being and going out there and looking at these things tells us where those connections are. So we come back to the story. I had a high school student at MIT who walked into my door, and he was looking for a science project. I was in my office. And there was a fly in my office buzzing around. I built tools to study biology, and I said, geez, this looks like a funny thing we should catch. So this is the exact fly that we caught. And I'm going to show you very quickly all kinds of amazing things that are in there. So this is the first look. You take any fly, you give it a drop of water with a little bit of sugar. You look from the top, just from any regular camera. So this is the mouth part, and it's fluctuating around 7 hertz. The drop acts as a lens, so you get to see a little deeper. So no other tools other than a camera. The thing about this feeding mechanism is the fact that physically it should not be possible. As you add more and more sugar to water, it turns from water to honey. Honey is really hard to pump. It's like cement at that length scales when you go smaller. So how are these creatures doing something that we have no idea how to do? So we go set up an experiment. We build an X-ray microscope, which is really fantastic because we get to see what's in them rather than just from the outside. So these are the images of some of the flies. And we press a button, the same technology that you get CAT scans from. We can do an exact morphological rendering of every single muscle in the head of a fly. So I have to say the fly had to be sacrificed for this particular experiment. But you see all the little tiny details. It turns out their feeding tube goes through a hole in their brain, which is very bizarre for why that should be the case. So I'm actually just going to show you the movies. Let's see. So this is the first time anybody has ever seen. For hundreds of years, we have known the morphology of these things. There have been entomologists out there. This is the first time that we can see live. This is a fly feeding with a head pointing upwards, tiny little drop. And you notice that little loop right there with the tiny little dark fluid. So that we spike up the fluid with an X-ray adsorbent material so you can actually see it. And it's pulsating its little muscle at 7 hertz. And it has two passive valves on the two sides that open and close completely passively to be able to actually regulate this pump. So let me show you another one of a bumblebee, which might be exciting. So what's going on is, as I just said, there is that little dilator muscle out there that's actually pulsating at the same time it's switching on and off the two passive valves at the edge, and that's how it's pumping fluids. And it turns out this is a very generic principle. Then we went out there and we caught everything we could that would feed. It's very hard to feed these things. They will die, but they will not eat what you've offered. So we turned out bumblebees, we know what they feed. So this is a bumblebee. It's hard to see, but if you notice, it's a very similar mechanism working with a very similar principles. So these are very generic principles when you go out and look for them. You might ask, oh, is this even useful? That's the first infusion pump that we built. We still put motors and gears inside human bodies for implantable devices. This is a far better way of doing something like that if you actually want a real solution that will last for a very long time. So I'm going to close very quickly. I think I'm running out of time. What can you do out there? Take your bag of tools, whatever those tools are, and go on a walk, look at stuff, find stuff. If you find something that you don't know, go pick it up. Actually, figure out what it is, what it does. Talk to your friends. And we organize these walks for basically everybody on campus to go out there and make your own discovery. And believe me, it's fairly easy once you start poking at these things because there are so many of them. Thank you so much.